I'm going to teach you about protocols in Swift. I'll explain what they are, the benefits, and how to implement them. And I'll show you some examples of protocols built right into the Swift language that you've probably used before and didn't even realize what's going on. So hopefully after this video, you'll be able to make that connection and have a better understanding of Swift protocols. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. You can think of a protocol as a standard set of instructions that other types in your code can adopt. And by standard set of instructions, I mean, you know, properties and functions. Let me show you the identifiable protocol in Swift, which is a really, really basic example. So here in Xcode, I have a brand new Swift UI project. So down here below the preview, I'm just gonna create a struct called book. And, you know, let's say a book has a author that's of type string and a title that is also of type string. Just super basic example. Now to conform to a protocol, after the book, you do colon and then you type the protocol. So we're gonna do identifiable. We already got the autocomplete. Now you're gonna see we're gonna get an error because type book does not conform to the protocol identifiable. And normally you can get some protocol stubs here, add stubs for conformance. Now the reason I started with identifiable is because the requirement, the standard set of instructions for this protocol is, hey, this type just has to have an ID property. That's why it gave us var ID. Now object identifier, I typically do a UUID, which is a unique identifier. This can also be a string, like maybe in the case of a book, like for the library, this is a ISBN number, which is a real long identifier. It just needs to be unique. So I typically do UUID and that satisfies the protocol requirement. So again, the standard set of instructions to conform to the identifiable protocol is to just have an ID property. That's about as simple as you can get. And protocols don't have to be crazy complex. As you can see, that's identifiable. Equatable or equitable, however you say it, is roughly the same thing. So protocols can be very simple and lightweight. But let's move on to a more unique example and something you might see in an app. Let's say we're building an app that allows our user to wander around the wilderness and tame wild animals. And there's just all sorts of animals. But in our app, not all of them are tameable. You know, for example, we can tame a dog or a cat, but we can't tame a grizzly bear or a lion. And as you can see in this list of pets, we have the pet name, the owner name, and a button that allows you to play with your pets. Now the name, owner name, play action, these are all things that are unique to animals that are tamed. Like wild animals don't have an owner name, they don't have a name, and you can't play with them. So this is a perfect opportunity to use a protocol where we define a standard set of instructions or properties and methods that a type in our app can conform to. So for us, that's gonna be a protocol called tameable. And tameable is gonna have, again, the name, the owner name, the emoji, and some functions like play and protect. So let's write that code. Well, first of all, let's get rid of our book. That was just the identifiable example. But here below the preview, we'll still do this. So to define a protocol, just write protocol, and then we'll say tameable. Now, when it comes to naming of protocols, usually they are able, like tameable, identifiable, codable, equitable, custom string convertible. Now this isn't necessarily a hard and fast requirement and sometimes the naming doesn't really work out, but if you can, that's typically how protocols are named. The standard set of instructions that we need for our app, like I said, this is a specific use case for what we need. We want to show a list of these tamed animals. Now when defining our standard list of instructions, which are the properties and the functions, we're just defining what they are. We are not actually implementing the code here. So for properties, we need to have the property name, the type, and whether this is read or write. So that's get or set. Let me write this out and we'll explain that. Var name is the first one. That's a string. You can see that is a get and a set. Now the reason it's a get and a set is because we want to be able to read the name property, but we also, in our hypothetical app, want to be able to set the name property, meaning we can overwrite it. You can imagine in this app, we capture it and then a little thing pops up and we type in the name. We get to name the animal we captured. That's why I want to have it as a set as well. Now we also need an owner name. That is also a string. Now this could be get or set. This is just app specific, but I want to show you an example where it's just a get. Again, if we wanted the user to be able to type in the owner name, sure, make it a set. Maybe this is an app where we just use the user's name, right? If I'm the user of the app, I catch it, I'm going to be the owner. So maybe this is just a get and we just read that property. But if the behavior of the app, you wanted them to be able to overwrite the name, you would mark that as set. And same thing for the emoji, say string, we're just gonna have it as a get. If you want them to be able to override the emoji and set a custom one, cool, make it a set. So like I said, here for the properties, we're not defining what they are, we're just defining the name of the property, and then is it readable or writable or both. Now, when it comes to the functions, you just type out the function signature. So play and func protect. Like these are things a tamed animal might be able to do in our app. Now, these can also take in parameters. Maybe play had a style and it was, you know, swift.ruff. You can take in parameters, and then you also can return, you know, values, but our simple example is just going to be a very basic function of just play and protect. And again, you're not defining what play does, you're not defining what protect does. You're just saying, hey, if an animal is tameable, it has to have a function called play. And then for each animal, you have to implement, you know, what play means for a dog, what play means for a cat. But here in the protocol, you just define the function signature. And again, these are super basic examples. They can't have parameters and they can't have return types. And real quick, if you're enjoying my teaching style and you want to go deeper with Swift and Swift UI, I have courses that are made up of, you know, 50 to 60 videos each, and we really go in depth building out more robust apps. You can check that out at seanallen.teachable.com. All right, now that we've defined our tameable protocol, let me bring in some animal objects so we can start conforming to this protocol. All right, I copy and pasted this over to save some time if you want to pause the video and type that out. But essentially, I have a dog object, a cat object, and a grizzly bear object. And this is to simulate all the different types of animals that would be in our wild animal capturing app. And I put some basic functions on here like bark, eat for a dog, stalk, eat for a cat, and a grizzly bear can attack or hibernate. These are things that are unique to that animal. Now, of course, this is two basic functions. In a real full-fledged app, a dog may be very complex. A cat could be much more complex. A grizzly bear could be more complex. But I wanted to highlight that these are the things that are unique to a dog, a cat, and a grizzly bear. So in our app, we have a bunch of different animal types that all have different behaviors. However, we have a standard set of instructions called tameable that if an animal in our app can be tamed, and in our example, we're gonna say a dog and a cat can be tamed, a grizzly bear cannot be tamed. So we wanna conform dog and cat to tameable, but grizzly bear won't conform to tameable because, hey, I don't wanna tame a grizzly bear. So to conform a type like dog to tameable, you do a colon and then tameable, just like we did with identifiable for our book example. Now again, type dog does not conform to the protocol tameable. That is because in order to conform to this protocol, to say, hey, I wanna sign up to be tameable, you have to implement all these. You have to have a name, an owner name, an emoji. You have to have a function called play and a function called protect, right? If you can be tamed, you have to have these things. And the reason being is that you'll see later when we actually use our protocol, Swift will know that if something is marked tameable, it's going to have all these things. And that's gonna let Swift, the language, act accordingly and us to be a lot more flexible with our code, which you'll see in a little bit. So let's hit the add stubs for conformance. I don't like all this spacing, so I'm gonna get rid of that, get rid of these spaces. And then here is where we would implement the code for play. And again, play can be different for a dog. Play can be different for a cat. This can be unique to the dog, right? A dog may play differently than a cat. You just have to have the function play that can be called. So I'm gonna just get rid of that here and keep it as an empty function for now. Just remember there would be code in here that would either play or protect. And it doesn't have to be the same for everything that conforms to tameable. It can be unique to a dog, unique to a cat. Now for the emoji, I am going to set this equal to a dog emoji. And then we'll make our cat tameable. So again, just conform to tameable. I always like to wait for the error message so I know I get all the stubs I need. Okay, let's get rid of the extra spacing they add in there. And then, like I said, for play, this is where you put in the code for to actually make the cat play and actually make the cat protect you. But for the sake of the tutorial, we're not worried about that. We're just worried about conforming. But you can see dog and cat have, well, actually, let me add the emoji for a cat here. As you can see, so dog and cat have a lot of common functions. They can both play and protect, but they also have unique functions, eat and bark and stalk and eat. Well, I guess eat's common, but that's irrelevant. And you may be thinking to yourself right now, like, well, didn't we just duplicate all this code right here? Like, why did I have to create a protocol to do that? Why don't I just have all of my animals that can be tamed have these properties? Well, that's where actually using the protocol comes into play. Because look at this list here. Hopefully you're familiar enough with Swift UI that you know to make a list, you need to have an array. And in Swift, arrays have to be the same type. So in our case of showing a list of all the pets, well, our pets could be a dog, a cat, or any other animal. And those are all very different types. So what this protocol allows us to do, again, this common set of instructions, is create an array of things that are tameable. And now Swift knows, oh, I can make an array of things that are tameable because I know everything in this array will at least have these properties and these functions. So you can kind of think about it, at least in this scenario, as like a unifying type for other types beneath it. So let's do that up in our code up here. Let's create our array. We can say let pets, and that is of type. Normally I would say dog, and it would be an array of dogs or cats or whatever, but I wanna have a bunch of different types in here, so I can do tameable. So anything that conforms to tameable can now go into this array. Equals, and we'll have our first dog with a name and an owner name. Say the name is Archer, owner is Sean, and I'll just do a couple of these. Cat, name and owner name. I need some commas there in my array. Garfield, and the owner name is Jim. Dog, name, Max, owner name, Sean. I guess I got two dogs. And then cat, we'll say, Hobbs, and then the owner name is Calvin. So again, the power of the protocol here, this is like a major benefit, is that I can have an array of different types, but they all conform to tameable. So now they can be in the same array, and now I can do all the array things, right? Arrays are very flexible. You can do a lot of things once you have something into an array. But in our case, we want to put them into a list to display in the user interface. So let's write out our list here. So get rid of that VStack. Give me a navigation stack. And in that navigation stack, I have a list and I want data, ID, row content. Now I do need an ID. So tameable, I forgot to add this here. We'll have to have also an ID property, and that is of type UUID, and it'll be a get. So now in our dog, we'll say var ID equals UUID, just like I talked about with identifiable before. You can't conform, like it'd be nice if tameable could like conform to identifiable. You can't really do that in this case. There's some clunky ways to make that work, but that's well beyond the scope of this basic tutorial. So I'm giving my dog and cat IDs here to conform to tameable equals UUID. And you see I got the message, the cat does not conform to tameable because it didn't have an ID property. As soon as I gave it that ID property, which I put on tameable, that error went away. So now that I have an ID here, I can say list of pets, ID is the key path, dot ID. That is because anything tameable does have that ID property. Now the row content, pet, and this is some basic UI here. We'll just not get too fancy here. HStack, first thing we're gonna do is have a text of pet.emoji. And I don't really like this autocomplete fully, so we'll say text pet.name, spacer, text pet.ownername. And I wanna talk about these properties real quick here in a second. And then we'll say button play, pet.play. I'm gonna type all this out and come back and explain it. And then we'll say dot button style is dot bordered prominent and dot control size dot mini. Give me a small button there. Not the prettiest UI, but you get what's going on here. So because we have an array of tameable, we are limited here in this specific circumstance to only the tameable properties. So here's ID, name, owner name, emoji, play, and protect. We're not doing anything with protect, but I just put play on there just so you can see that, hey, if you want to play with your pets, you can do that in the list here. Because play is a tameable function. For example, you would not have access to pet.bark because that is not part of tameable, that is part of dog. You would not have access to pet.stock because that's specific to cat. So that is one thing to keep in mind when using protocols this way. You would only have access to the standard set of instructions that we defined that apply to a tameable animal, which in our case, hey, we just want the name, the owner name, and we want to be able to play with our pet. So that's what's going on up here in the list, how we have a pet, which again is tameable, and then we can use the tameable properties, emoji, name, owner name, play, down here in our list. And then just to finish out the UI, dot navigation title, pets. There we go. So the key thing to remember is that a protocol is a standard set of instructions. Here's that standard set of instructions, which again are properties and functions. And in the protocol, you just define the property name, the type, and whether you can read or write. You don't actually define like what the ID is or what the name is. Same thing with the functions, just define the function signature. You don't actually write the code in the functions. That is to be implemented specifically on the dog or the cat or whatever conforms to tameable. So to back away from this specific example around animals and if they can be tamed, the general principle is if you have a set of behaviors, properties, and functions that you want any type to conform to, right? The other example was identifiable, where all you needed was an ID property. That's the perfect use case for a protocol. And if you're here learning about protocols, I know you're building awesome apps, and I think it's best to have a portfolio website to showcase your work, let people know what you can do. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.